Normally, in March and April, this is frozen solid all the way to the outside lead, another 20 mile out here.
It's not supposed to be like this up here 30 miles north of the Arctic Circle.
You got to recognize this as a threat to life on this planet.
The ice out here stopped growing in the middle of winter.
This is going to be the fourth year where we have no ice in the ocean. That's unheard of. And there are times when I went out here to hunt, I'd go 65 miles out, straight out in the ocean and hunt. Now I can go a mile and a half, 4 miles.
There's been abrupt and unexpected and unprecedented changes in the sea ice.
This past several years, we couldn't go out there because we didn't have stable landfast ice soon enough throughout the winter. The ice that we're standing on just kind of formed here January. It should have been frozen in October.
Literally, life is at stake. That I feel it's my responsibility to try and help with.
Hi, my name is Sarah Miuk-Betcher. I'm the documentary filmmaker for the Ikaaġvik Sikukun Project. This project was based out of the remote rural community of Kotzebue, Alaska, between the Bering and Chukchi Seas, with research being conducted in Kotzebue Sound. I'd like to share with you how our collaborative project was led by an Indigenous Advisory Council in cooperation with scientists to understand how sea ice, the ocean, and marine mammals are changing in Kotzebue Sound. Recent years have seen dramatic losses of winter sea ice in the Bering and Chukchi Seas, accompanied by warmer and warmer ocean temperatures during the summer months. For most of our elders' lifetimes, Kotzebue Sound was completely covered by ice during the winter, providing an important platform for hunters and travelers. The ice cover has become less reliable in the 21st century, and during the years of the Ikaaġvik Sikukun Project, most of Kotzebue Sound remained open water throughout each winter.
It took a new Nakhulit Tizat, Nigapom, Tunganin, Arctic Circle Room, Kikirtami, Takipluni, Kikirtarum, Imanganun, Ilulak, Ungalamlu, Kivakamlu, Chakchisim. Angunaru root, Tema, Angunahuta, Akalungnik, Pukukuta, Nakhsarnahuta, Akalungnik.
What we call black meat or dried meat that's mixed into the seal oil, we use that a lot for our main dishes. That's just how important it is. I give credit to our oceans mainly because of the seal and the oil and the long shelf life it's got. A lot of the coastal people depended on bearded seal mainly because we might be harvesting in June and preserving and putting away, but we're actually making our food that's gonna bring us through the winter months, and it's a main part of our staple of diet.
Tarim siko atarok inyuhlarmi ukimilu upinrakshamilu ilichurneel ha tarim sikunganik kapyaneilakun at kunahuni inyuneel ha digun inyupta nanipayak inyunarvibdikni. Uvagut utokanani is komagikput kikertaruk matukaktok sikumik atanun aglan ukir natlu aglan akulerni ukini imanga ang maksimo rao sirok. Una sa wakput kangar si Mafsaro Klugo, kanok tarim si Go at langokman asin kanok si Vniksangat tarim si Go suli inigikangat neksat ang unarvet suli iglirarviksangat inyupta.
An important facet of the project has always been to have a legacy. How to do this co-production of knowledge where it starts in the community and we work together throughout the project from the beginning.
Everyone was on an equal plane and we're all creating it together at the same time. And it's really exciting to be a part of a project like this.
So this week we're here in Kotzebue for our first site visit.
All right.
We had a few goals. First, we just wanted to introduce our project to the community of Kotzebue. Through one of our team members, Alex Whiting, we wanted to identify people in the community who provided interest in collaborating with us scientists.
One of the important things besides studying the physics of Kotzebue Sound was to have Indigenous people inserted into the project. So we developed a tribal advisory council. They're very knowledgeable about sea ice, the ecology of Kotzebue Sound, and the physical nature of ice. And they helped us design research questions based on their experience and knowledge over the years. They're all sort of in their 60s and 70s, so they've been around Kotzebue Sound that entire time.
We came and found the biggest whiteboard that we could find in Kotzebue Sound so that we could try and visualize what came up from talking with elders yesterday as we took our first attempt to try and understand what the important questions are that locals here living in Kotzebue have about the sea ice.
And hopefully you feel like we so far are at least capturing what you've told us the other day and are listening.
We felt that we found five or six interrelated questions emerge out of the discussion.
It's really fascinating.
Savaktit ichakshanik pilwilapaktonik inyunginyi kiktarum suli kigutikshat UAV nik naka UAV's drone suli atlanik savalgotinik yusimarot atukanginyik.
Six initial questions were developed, but due to the anomalous years of little sea ice in Kotzebue Sound during our research project, some aspects were not able to be researched. And we added the question of, why was there so little sea ice in 2018 and 2019?
So one of the key components of this project is to fly UAVs, drones, out over the sea ice. So we need to have a nice, big, wide open space to keep the drones when we're not flying and prep them. We've homed in on the Fish and Wildlife Hangar. We met Dave.
This is our building. More Fish and Wildlife can utilize it with partners.
Our team grew over the first year to consist of roughly 20 people who participated in collecting and contributing information. Each person played an important role.
in Kotzebue in the middle of October. We're here for the week, a big group of us from the entire project to talk to the community. And this afternoon we're going to go to the high school and have a chat to the kids in their employment class, a group of visiting scientists from all around the world.
We're back to Alaska and I want to bring my knowledge and expertise on marine mammals back to the state.
My degree is in wildlife biology and I chose that just because I've always really loved animals. I wanted to learn more about them.
I'm here to contribute to the area.
How do we cite oral tradition in an academic journal?
And studying how waves break on the beach.
Anybody have any questions about the work that these guys are doing in Kotzebue?
We brought one of the prototypes or the display models of the drone.
Actually works really well in this car.
Yeah, right, it's like it was made for it.
This is very tail heavy, so that when the payload is on it on the nose, it balances. Since this was just for a show airplane, it doesn't have all the pockets cut out. Ailerons, the elevators, and the rudders.
To show people what it was looking like and what the kind of things we're going to be doing with it. And also some of the ice thickness measurement instruments and snow depth measurement and thermal cameras and things, just to talk with the community about that.
Is that the name of the project?
Yeah. Yeah, it's Ice Bridges.
And do a few other things, like talk on the radio.
And you're listening to KOTZ Kotzebue. We have some guests in the studio.
Today we're going to talk about Ikaaġvik Sikukun, Ice Bridges. We have some really special guests today, and I'll let them all introduce themselves.
John Goodwin Sr., Kate Tarumi.
Pearl Goodwin's Kotzebue.
Alex Wayne, environmental specialist, native village of Kotzebue.
So we're looking to recruit. We're hiring a local sea ice observer. If that sounds like a job that someone might like to do, go out on the sea ice once a week, learn how thick it is and report back to us. I think if you can get in touch with Alex Whiting, we should be able to set something up for you. This will be a paid position.
Aiga, what a great group of people here this morning. We want to thank you so much for joining us today, and welcome to Kotzebue. For some of you, welcome to this awesome state of Alaska.
What makes the Ice Bridge project truly unique is the traditional knowledge component of listening to the community leaders.
It would just be interesting to be able to correlate the temperature, the wind, and the ice as far as the disappearance.
Listening to the elders.
I witnessed the erosions. I witnessed the warming of the air and the warming of the waters. As an elder, you become more perceptive, I guess, and you get to see what's happening today versus when I was a child growing up back in the 50s.
Understanding their wisdom and then using that to inform our scientific hypotheses. I've never seen that in a project before. An incredible opportunity, scientifically and then also in terms of giving us the opportunity to push the envelope on how these types of phenomena are studied.
Do thick ice years lead to a longer bearded seal hunting season? I can speculate about ways that that might play out. That is a hypothesis that I would put forward.
Ikaaġlugu kangaqsimeelxat nalunartuut apersuutit kigutitlu
during the fall time when we get really low water and we can't use this inside bay, where we would connect to that Kobuk channel out there, heading out this way, but we got to get around that one shallow spot, which is roughly about straight out this way.
We're going to bring three aircraft up. This version is our latest, largest, and most capable vehicle. They're called HQ-90s. HQ stands for hybrid quadrotor, in that it's a combination of vertical takeoff and landing, what we call VTOL capability, and fixed wing. So we're able to take off and land vertically, which means that we don't need a runway or launchers or nets to recover them. And then it transitions to fixed wing flight, and we can get the endurance and range of a traditional airplane. So this is about 100 pound aircraft. So it's not a small little quadcopter that you'd see flying around. We're gonna be going, you know, hundreds of kilometers out for some of the missions, and other missions we might stay a little closer, but we're gonna be really pushing the bounds of what kind of data can be captured by enabling the scientists to get their instruments out to areas that they haven't been able to get to.
When we got here, there was quite a bit of work to do when we finally got boots on the ground. First of all, we had to go coordinate with all the local companies and the airport manager, make sure everybody was in the loop on what we were gonna be doing.
It sounds like you're gonna be going out before we're even here in the morning generally.
After we unpacked all the equipment, we did a lot of checkouts on the equipment, and we had to do functional check flights on all three airplanes before we go about putting any sensors on the airplane for actual science missions.
Stand up.
After we rolled into short science flights and started collecting data.
Currently, I'm just setting up flight plans to do our first flight on this airplane. Getting familiar with the airspace, make sure we can deconflict with other aircraft easily.
So we're doing a zigzag, and then when we get to Blossom, we want to map as much as possible over the ice.
One of the really exciting aspects has been the opportunity to work with cutting-edge UAV technology. UAVs are uncrewed aerial vehicles, and the ones that we used on this project are known as hybrid quadrotors. This is an HQ-90. Chris Zappa's lab at Lamont-Doherty Earth Observatory of Columbia University developed a system for attaching new payloads to the front of the aircraft to fit our scientific objectives. Payloads that I'm focusing on here are codenamed RAD and VNIR. The RAD payload gives us information about the total solar and thermal radiation coming from below and above the aircraft. This allows us to compute the albedo, or how good the ice is at reflecting sunlight. The VNIR payload is named for its visible near-infrared sensor, something called a hyperspectral camera. The calibrated output of the sensors on the VNIR payload give us information about the surface reflectance as a function of light wavelength, from just above ultraviolet to the near infrared. Essentially, we used the UAV as a mobile platform for sensing the radiative properties of the ice surface. Ice geophysicists that are interested in sea ice radiative properties will often install a fixed sensor on the sea ice and track the radiation budget over time. They'll do this for snow-covered ice surfaces, bare ice, melt ponds, etc. So you get a broad data set with a long time series, but you don't get too much in the way of spatial information. So satellite measurements are often used to complement this by giving you large-scale picture of what's happening there and a time resolution of every few days, but they don't have especially fine spatial resolution. On the other hand, the UAV measurements that we made gave us pretty broad coverage and high resolution, so really able to get at some of the smaller features on the ice surface. This is what that looks like in practice. The red, green, and blue channels of the sea ice surface reflectance data can be used to reconstruct a color image of the surface, more reflective versus less reflective, within a single shot that you see on the left. Open water and melt ponds tend to reflect bluish light and absorb radiation in the red and near-infrared wavelengths, absorbing a lot of radiation from the sun.
Our next step is going to be to use the spatial properties of our measurement to see if small features, say melt ponds or cracks, have a measurable impact on the radiative fluxes. This information will improve our understanding of sea ice dynamics in the Arctic and help to inform how we describe these regions using models.
The use of UAVs gave us the ability to use specialized scientific instruments to research the sea ice.
Transition!
Operations were especially challenging the first field season, however, due to navigating under COA, Certificates of Authorization, restrictions which are issued by the FAA, the Federal Aviation Administration. These provisions meant that we had to keep our UAV in our sight, and we did this by following it mostly from snow machines. This limited how far out from Kotzebue we could go due to the limited sea ice coverage and thin sea ice conditions.
All of a sudden we heard that the drone had to be followed. It had to have line of sight at all times. That limited us because we couldn't get to the ocean because it was just too dangerous. They couldn't go more than 2 miles out. Now we're here in Sisolik for the first day, and maybe 3/4 of a mile is the open water. Normally you can go all the way out there and get a lot more documentation of ice conditions out there, but it's not there. Just no ice to do anything with.
We've had to zigzag down the coastline so that our visual observers can keep up. But we're getting data the whole way, so it's good. Okay, seeing it. I see crosswind, looks good. The hangar we're operating from, it's right off of runway 1836 right here that runs north-south. And this is the main runway for the airport, 927. So we're not far at all from the main runway, and that's why we have to consider traffic so much.
We're here on the coast at the south edge of Kotzebue by the airport, waiting for the drone to take off a short distance away from us.
Launch now. Spin up.
We got the drone in the air right there. It just took off from the hangar, and right now it's climbing to elevation in a rounded square. Our target elevation is 1,000 feet, so they just hold this square pattern until the drone is at 1,000 feet, and then they'll radio us and let us know it's time to go down the coast. Copy that, we're ready, over. Down about 10 miles to Cape Blossom, where we're hoping to map the edge of the ice, where the landfast ice ends and the ocean begins. Also, once we get down to the edge, I'm gonna help direct the pilots to exactly where the ice edge is, because that changes on a daily basis. Yesterday, we followed this track that we're gonna follow again today, south.
Okay, we're gonna start working it south.
Copy that. Taking a tight tack where we would go from the coast out a mile and back, looking at the ice surface on the way down to approximately Cape Blossom, and then turned around and did the same thing on the way back.
Kotzebue radio and aircraft 18 Charlie Uniform, currently 4 miles south of the airport, slowly working our way north. Kotzebue.
So we are here at Cape Blossom, about 10 miles south of Kotzebue. We've been flying the UAV today and mapping the ice edge behind me. There are quite a few seals out on the ice. I think they may have popped up in response to the sunny conditions. So we definitely got some of those in the imagery. Working our way up the coast, getting high spatial resolution map of the ice edge here.
The blue is the flight track, and the green is the track of the visual observer, aka me, on the snow machine.
Inyupta lichorisimagat sikurok kikitarung mi akut mulha suli apudakse nyahuni. Harut ligic apudakak tu krorut sisikramik sogok inyuek silhat at langoruni damna simmerpan. Savakatigic inyaksirut nunangonik apudim khanganin khayo khlangnik suli nanunakhliwich sisinginik.
My role in the project has been to work on the ring seal denning habitat question put forward by the elders.
Sisamat aperchutat animlu sikumlu khangani dom khanok ikiyuto ragelkha kharot ligich sisini inyornel khatlu.
Ring seals are unique from other ice-associated seals in that they depend not only on sea ice, but also on the snow on top of the ice. Ring seals construct snow-covered dens or layers that protect their pups from predators and the cold. And it's important that we learn more about the habitat seals need for these layers to better understand how they'll be affected by climate change.
I've been helping with the drone portion of the field season, helping to come up with flight tracks that go over areas of interest, including overlapping with the areas that we visited on the ice.
We were flying two cameras today, a thermal camera that measures the temperature of the ice or the ocean and may tell us why there's such an early breakup of our receding ice edge this year. And we're also looking at the ocean edge to see how much warming there is in the ocean. And the thermal camera tells us about seals because they show up as really bright features on the cold sea ice background, and a visible camera so we can see what we're actually looking at in the thermal camera.
The team will use the data and images collected by the drones to watch how the surface changes as melt continues and look for seal structures that may be exposed as snow thins and disappears. The team also used a wide variety of on-ice instruments to research climate, weather, density of ice, and marine mammals.
Hanger, skittle.
Two spring field seasons of roughly a month long were dedicated to collecting data.
Off of the laser.
We spent time out on the ice, finding out the thickness of the ice.
He reads it off the marker, it'll tell you.
We put it in the water. Chukchi water is about 32 parts per thousand.
I could see which way the current's going.
We've made measurements of the ocean underneath the ice.
Negative freeboard.
49.
Put a camera down the hole, see what the ice looks like from underneath.
The Ikaaġvik Sikukun team concentrated their on-ice scientific observations during the early stages of spring melt while the shorefest ice populated by ring seals was still accessible. The team also used a wide variety of on-ice instruments to research how the thickness of ice and its surface changed over the course of the season, and how this affected the habitat the ice could provide for marine mammals. Andy describes to me how the laser scanner collects useful information that allows us to create a 3D terrain map of the top surface of the ice and snow. The team did a survey at a site where they found a seal lair, so they could learn more about the habitat features that the seal selected, which is revealed in the imagery. Donna used a magna probe to measure the snow depth, which can be combined with data collected by the laser scanner to understand the topography of the ice under the snow.
I am using this instrument called a magna probe to collect information on the snow depth on top of the ice. So you kind of got to make sure that it's in the right spot, dig it in, push the button, it takes a really quick measurement of the snow depth. We're just trying to take kind of a random sample of snow depth throughout the area that we're surveying with the terrestrial LIDAR.
This graph is an example of a transect that shows the height of the sea ice surface relative to the sea level and the depth of the snow above it. If there's a seal layer in ice below sea level, it is more susceptible to becoming flooded, which can impact the integrity of the layer for newborn pups.
Utokanat, Tikorlugu, Iglernak Dilak, Sukun, Apotikor Tikun, Suli, Ko Tip Lugich, Ismap Lugu Inni, Utlakarting.
Holy smoke, there's a nice little bunch right there.
Like my dad said, in the last 25, 30 years, never seen storms that strong in his lifetime. He was on this earth for 91 years, you know. He talked about thawing of the permafrost and how it's so evident that it's happening. Huge changes. Look at this. Just saw 20 seals go by just in the last half hour, 45 minutes. What's happening is that the concentrations of seals are going to where there is ice, and there isn't too many places there's ice. This is an example of what's happening, is they're concentrating because they have to have ice. We used to come out here this time of the year because we knew the ice was going to be 5 foot thick, you know. And it's been like that for probably thousands of years. But now the ice doesn't get thick anymore. Normally, in March and April, this is frozen solid all the way to the outside lead, where the lead normally is, which is about probably another 20 mile out here. This is unheard of. This is the third year in a row it's been like this. Things are changing real fast. We had record temperatures in February, you know, and normally that's your 30, 40 below month. Temperatures in February were above 20 degrees, all February.
I think that finding out as much as we can about ring seal habitat in a changing climate is really important. And it's a question that was asked by our elders, so we know that it's important to them and to the Kotzebue community and to other Alaska Native communities who use ring seals and other ice seals as a resource. And we want to know as much about what their needs are and how they might be affected, facing some challenges with climate change. So we hope that the results generated from this project will be of value to the elders here, to the Kotzebue community, and hopefully to other Alaska Native communities as well who rely on seals as a resource.
In the second field season, instead of following the UAVs by line of sight from snow machines, we decided to use what we called a chase plane. This allowed us to go as far as our UAVs could go instead of traveling only above safe ice conditions. The chase plane used was a two-seater, so one of our researchers could be on board to keep an eye on the UAV while also taking photos or videos of the ice, the UAV, or any wildlife spotted.
We've been operating drone flights with the chase plane for over 2 weeks now. We're getting 2 to 3 and even maybe 4 flights in a day.
Yeah, it was really interesting up there. Just in the hour and a half flight time that we had, the conditions totally changed, the color of the ice totally changed, and the channel is very distinct. It's not broken through yet, it's still ice, but it's much darker than the surrounding ice. But it's much harder to spot the drone when it's flying over open water than it is over ice, because the color of the water camouflages the gray drone much better than the bright white ice. But it's important to us to get flux measurements over that transition area between the ice and the water, so continue to do that and just keep a close eye on it when it's out there over water.
Ten feet, 5 feet. Final approach.
100 feet high. 2661, final approach, fixed inbound, running back.
Another part of the field season this year that was especially valuable for me was getting to be an observer in the chase plane following the drone. Getting to see that ice from the air was a whole new perspective at such a broad spatial scale. The way that ring seals were clustered around ridges and snowdrifts. And that was also helpful context for me going through the drone imagery. After the field seasons have ended, I've been looking through the imagery collected by the drones to find seals that the drone detected. And so what I'm doing now is going through those images collected from the drone with a finer toothed comb to make sure that I've really gotten all of the seals that we observed and that I've recorded as much information as possible about the age and the species of those seals, and for pups, trying to record what color their coat is, whether they're still white-coated with their lanugo or whether they've molted into a darker color, so that we can use that as an index of how old the pups are at the time that we're observing them.
Most of the questions ended up something to do with the marine mammals that inhabit the sea ice, primarily the ringed seals, the natchik, and the bearded seals, the ugruk, that occupy the sea ice during the winter and the springtime.
Out of the 6 questions created by the team, 3 of them were specific to marine mammals.
A person, civil lakbak, sut darim irusin angalad pong nexane kirtarum imangani. A person, kanok darim irusin angaladak pagich darim angmaningi. Inok naktot ugrungun suli sisot isilhat kirtarumun. Inyupta angunarech matko nexat. Ikayu torut. Natchich nerekangat inyupta isumalugi matun itkikput. Natchich okshot okshuliakhlugu ilyagigat nerekangat. Nekhalu tingolu suli ingalot nepok poraktut iwikabot kawat lingna hutinglu sikumin tamna ukim ilangani itok.
These seals we caught over at Shady Creek, just 7 miles south of Kotzebue.
After a while, I'll look inside the hole and see if there's the seal might be sticking out.
And the lead is just a little ways offshore, about 1.5 to 2 miles, to harvest a seal.
I've been participating in the on-ice field work, going out and doing habitat surveys.
The idea is to look down in the seal hole and just get some underwater video to determine if there's any structure we can see.
This hardened, iced over section of the snow where you can tell that the seal had come in and out of the water, and potentially where the seal was coming in and out over in this lower section, this depression over here.
So it's actually difficult to get to the hole itself.
We're back out here in front of Sisolik, roughly about 1 mile off the beach on the channel that heads out to the Kotzebue Sound. And here we have appears to be a denning area with a little roofing site on there where the pup is being protected while the mother is out here. So she's leaving a little blood behind, so which I'm guessing is from birthing.
Ring seals and other ice-associated species are going to be facing some challenges with climate change. We want to know as much about what their needs are and how they might be affected.
One of the biggest changes that we notice is that the water is much warmer. And as winters have no ice, the sun warms up the water so much earlier. This will be our 4th year that our ocean has not froze. And the only place that it froze was along the shallow islands that we have near Kotzebue. And it presents a lot of problems for all the animals, including the humans. What happens is that the seals have to have their young closer to shore
because they got no ice to go to, except for the landfast ice, which is 4 or 5 miles out to 8 miles out, and some places only 1.5 miles out. And so they have really no places to make their dens now, because we don't have any big piles of ice like we used to have.
The sea ice didn't get thick enough, so a lot of us that go seal hunting didn't do that this year because it was just too unsafe, more so this year than last.
We've had to modify our way of hunting, and we've also had to become very, very careful. Last 2 years, I have not hunted in the spring because it's so different that I don't want to lose my life, because you can't read the ice as well as we used to. The way of reading the ice is no longer valid. It's changed so much. And our springs and our falls are becoming longer and longer, whereas our winter is shorter and shorter. At one point in time, we used to have 9 months of winter. Now we think we have about 6 months of winter, or maybe less. It limits you as to what you can do when you're looking for food.
Ma'nga enyupet urung naaraktut ang makman imak sikumi umaktut lasik biwich urung nun sikuni puktaroni uvlupak inyuik kabot urung naaraktut sikut hangat ni kibit humit kalok luwich no tamlu kuvomlu kungik sarvaktuk tarimun imek kungnin iglek maknik tamna savarip lugo.
So much of our way of life is not only physical in terms of getting out to the country to get the food, but it's also very spiritual to a lot of our people. We've done this so many years, and there's certain ways to do things that indicate how spiritual it is. Even something as simple as hunting for elders is spiritual, in that when you bring food to the elders, they tell you, Deku, thank you. And then they say that you're going to get more in return. And so when you're a 8-year-old boy, 10-year-old boy growing up, and the elder tells you that, you feel like you accomplished something and you're going to get better at it. In this way, we always make sure that the elders have food all the time.
Tugle apakrutim, sumte silami angalatakpago sivitutilanga. Angunarvim ugruptigun kikaktarungmi. Uma aperhutim tikisit ke savaktit sapernartot ilitkosich angalatarikanga nersarnelak.
The historical sea ice patterns started shifting around 2010. The ice conditions that used to occur during May and early June in the last decade are now starting to resemble those of what used to be June and July. We also used tribal records from the native village of Kotzebue. So since 2003, Alex Whiting, as the environmental program director, has been keeping a regular journal of hunting activities and associated environmental conditions in Kotzebue. That provided us with this very critical time series of the harvest season, because Alice was recording the start and end dates for when people were hunting for ugruk. Using Alex's journals, we quantified that on average, the hunt is now ending about 26 days earlier than it did in the early 2000s.
Darim siko atul laparat igla kaming anguna kaming nakinik tugbak tuy kaming lu. Ichakshat atakshutat subata sikungit pa kiktarung mi ukiung ni 2018 me, 2019
me. Local hunters and elders consistently report that Kotzebue Sound used to freeze over completely from coast to coast. allowing travel over the ice far out to sea. But this changed in recent years, and it's no longer safe to do so. Satellite data shows that prior to 2018, there had been a few years when the ice in the center of the sound was thin and mobile. But the near absence of ice in 2018 and 2019 witnessed by our team was unprecedented. Although ice in Kotzebue Sound returned to something more like normal in 2020 and 2021, the warm waters of the North Pacific that we believe led to the loss of ice in 2018 and 2019 are likely to return again, so our measurements may provide an indication of conditions that will become more common in the future.
Siku inok nalapaktok naksanak tuni ukimi upinramilyo asin angonelak inorik kaptiknik imanesun inreksok.
This year is different because this stayed open like this the whole winter.
Savakatigich kemenrorat ilichorisuklugu sukman sikulha nungukpa ukime kikiktarum imangani.
To better understand rapid sea ice loss in Kotzebue Sound, our team set up sea ice mass balance sites, which are used to understand the process of ice growth and melt.
So we put two sites out. We put one northeast of Kotzebue, trying to get into the bay area where there's not so much influence of the river. And then we put another one past the runway of the airport, right in the middle of the channel. We had a grid of 9 snow stacks on the inside, 2 meters apart from one another, and then 4 hot wire ice sticks that sit around the edges. We have someone in the community going out and doing measurements once a week. Someone does need to go out there and look at each stake and measure the snow depth on each one and the ice thickness.
So what Bobby's doing at the moment is putting a current through this wire, and the wire goes down under the ice and then back up. So basically as far as he can pull it up, and then he reads it off the marker, it'll tell you how thick that ice is. So we're out at what we call our Northern Bay Mass Balance Site. Bobby and Alex have been monitoring it weekly since then.
With the melting there, well, about a foot underneath there. With this research, we're able to be getting some measurements on snow depth. I'm right now just pulling these out. We're calling it the season. And of course, ice depths on the corner ones here before conditions deteriorate too much more.
We call them hot wire thickness gauges, and they're here to measure the thickness of the ice as it grows and then as it melts. We're doing this so that we can understand how the ice has been growing, both in this site where there is very little current, to the channel site, which is west of town, where there's been really strong current. And we can see what the difference in heat fluxes has been from the water column below.
Siliam at langoktom si mera inyo nilakput anoklaksom bumigsita huni nakikmalakha unaroksenya huni ukiyam nililha darim tukunanik mira nunam ata oklu upka huni inyuro tukupluting suli saglik yuni darim siko. Inyupta so atukiye utit lagalawat aglan at langoktom sukasipman at taknak sirok kanok atuk nelha imanesun inyunay lakput.
The blue skies out here is what we normally would look for when we're looking for open water. As you can see, these dark blue skies. On this direction toward my right, it connects over toward Sealing Point, which is another ideal place to where we would venture off to the ice to go and look for leads to hunt out of. But in this case, this year, we can't even leave the beach over at Sealing Point because it's open all the way to the beach.
Inyupet ilorod sukuak sinyaktone sumalunlu ilse magkartinglu Right.
Local resident Vince Schaefer was able to carry out ice and snow measurements at the ice mass balance sites over the winter, including taking measurements using a CTD, which stands for connectivity, temperature, and depth.
I'm gonna try to lower this down halfway just to get a temperature. And then after about 10 or so seconds of soaking, I'll lower it all the way down. And at the same time, I could see which way the current's going. And then I'm gonna pull it from the opposite direction, steady as I can, so that it'll get kind of a good reading coming back up. We just did our first drop. All right. I'm gonna come over to the app and see if we had a reading.
So you have conductivity, which is a measure of the salinity, so how fresh it is. So there's a lot more salinity at the bottom, and at the top it's fresher, which makes sense since we're in the river channel.
We're gearing up for our final day on the ice. We're gonna go pull out the mass balance site that's up in the bay, which was the last thing we did last year as well, but it was over 2 weeks later. But the ice is starting to get dangerous, so everybody who we trust about this ice says it's worth going out on.
You could drive probably a mile over and be safe, or maybe even 2 miles.
From the beginning, the project has always been to study the breakup processes, so we've always been trying to account for the fact that we're here in a time when the ice is thinning. So we're always checking in every day with our elder advisors and with Alex and seeing what they think about the ice and trusting their judgment.
It's melting quick. Uh-huh. It's now less than a mile and a half out from Shady Creek.
Wow.
Way, way in.
In the channel, the ice is getting down to say 9 inches or maybe even less. Out where we're going today, there's still a decent amount of ice. It's a place that generally grows more ice and breaks up pretty late, but the problem is getting there in the first place. So that's why we need to go now, because we have to get across some thinner ice in order to get there.
This is called the bay site. This is outside of town. It's called the Ilovac Bay. I'm gonna measure the ice with a weight. We've been going at them by the week. Started doing them twice a week. So I'm reading 22 inches of ice right now. So we're at 23 inches of snow just right here, right where I'm standing.
7, 8.
The measurements we conducted in 2018 and 2019 continued into 2020 through a partnership with the Alaska Arctic Observatory and Knowledge Hub, which helps strengthen the legacy of the Ikaaġvik Sikukun project.
We are here at the channel mass balance site, installing it for the third year running. We are in the river outflow channel right in front of town. So we're only like 1,000 yards from town, much closer than the other site. We installed the other site this morning. So we've just laid out the grid and now we're gonna start drilling holes and putting the stakes in. Thickness wise, over there, it was over 4 feet. Josh, what is it here?
3 foot, 4 inches.
This is the third year that I've helped install these mass balance sites in the same locations. And this is the first year where we've installed it while the sound was actually frozen over all the way to the mouth of the sound. So the ice is significantly thicker. We have to drill a lot deeper before we get to the water. We're also installing it a month later, so the ice has had more time to grow. But even so, it's thicker than it ever got the past 2 years. So in many ways, it's nice that we have this year as more of a baseline for what conditions are like in sort of a winter that people living in Kotzebue would consider to be more normal. The past few winters have been extremely anomalous. And it also gave us measurements to sort of verify the value of these ice thickness and snow depth measurements. They really are capturing what's going on in terms of heat input to the ice and how the ice grows. So it's great to have them back out here again this third year.
The ice mass balance sites are one of several ways the Ikaaġvik Sikukun team seeks to find ways to increase knowledge of how environmental factors affect the stability of sea ice in Kotzebue Sound.
Pingayot aperchutit sumur siku eglernak sidarelha kikertarum tareungani aperchun sabaregat ataki inyupta inureplugu kayang nature siku iglera kaming anguna kaming lu at langok si marok damna nuna unak talakman.
Our team was unable to research question 3. We were also unable to research question 5 due to the unprecedented lack of sea ice in 2018 and 2019. It was still important for the project as a whole to know what questions were important to the community so we could concentrate our efforts based on knowing what concerns Kotzebue people the most.
27.
There are basically 3 main findings looking at the mass balance data in conjunction with other observations that we made. Our first finding was that the sea ice in Kotzebue Sound in 2018 and 2019 was the thinnest since at least 1945.
Here is the 18 inches.
And this was caused by a combination of warm air temperatures, deep snow, and residual heat in the ocean. And we think that residual heat in the ocean is a new development. The residual heat was different in those 2 years. And then spring started early, so it started melting early, and this contributed to an early breakup of ice in the channel, which in turn allowed an early start to the bearded seal hunt, confirming other observations that had been made, like Alex's journal showing that the bearded seal hunt was really early in those 2 years. Lastly, we noticed that this combination of thin ice and deep snow increased the likelihood of surface flooding. So the weight of the snow pushing the thin ice down below sea level, causing the snow to flood before refreezing. We think that that was actually probably going to be a negative effect on ring seals trying to make a lair in that kind of ice. And that's still an open topic, but potentially a new finding that our work highlighted.
As Alex and Bobby made weekly measurements at the ice mass balance sites the first winter, we would look at the data they gathered to try to understand the driving factors behind the growth and melt of the ice. By the end of the winter, it became clear from the data that most of the heat responsible for melting the ice was coming from the water below, and we wanted to get a clear picture of when and how that melting was occurring. So we decided to install under ice measurements of the water temperature and currents at the mass balance site the following winter.
I just got back to Fairbanks from Kotzebue to put out 2 sea ice mass balance sites and deploy 2 ice tethered moorings.
They're both going to hang from the top of the ice, through the ice, and down in through the water column below the ice. And then there are all these metal cylinders, temperature recorders. And then the concerto, which records temperature, but also records the salinity of the water.
So this is an aqueduct. It has a little head on it with transducers that send out pulses of acoustic energy, so you can tell the speed and direction of the water as it passes by. So that'll help give us information about the current underneath the ice as it's melting or growing.
2 of these put in the water fairly close to each other, we're going to get a long view of what's going on with the currents underneath the ice and how that's transporting heat as well as salinity.
So that involved drilling some 10-inch holes in the ice.
We installed our equipment to measure water temperature and currents in the channel, where the Noatak and Kobuk rivers converge and flow into Kotzebue Sound. We found that the fresh water coming from the rivers during the winter was at its freezing point, meaning that it was not heating up the ice from below. In contrast, the salty ocean water was above the freezing point, showing us that the heat from the ocean was responsible for the ice loss we observed during the winter. However, because we installed all these measurements tethered directly to the ice itself, they only allowed us to gather a clear picture of what was happening during the winter while the ice was still thick enough for us to walk on. In order to understand the relative influences of the river and the ocean during the fall and spring, when the ice is first forming and when it's breaking up, we had to turn to another set of measurements, the ocean bottom tripod. During the first summer of the project, we installed underwater recorders of water temperature, salinity, and currents on a tripod, which we dropped into the ocean floor at the mouth of Kotzebue Sound to collect data for 2 years. We chose to place the ocean bottom tripod in the area where plumes of river water eventually leave Kotzebue Sound, hoping to measure river outflow as it passed by. And indeed, when we retrieved the tripod...
Hey, it's Carson calling from the sat phone. We went back out this evening and got it.
Yes!
As far as we can tell, in full working order.
And looked at the data, we were able to see a clear signature of fresh river water flowing out from Kotzebue Sound all year round. What we found was that during the fall and winter, the river water was much colder than the ocean, meaning that the rivers were helping the ice grow and even protecting the ice from warmer ocean water below. But during the spring, the river outflow was much warmer than the ocean and drove the breakup and melt of the ice in Kotzebue Sound.
There should be a buoy right directly in front of us.
I got involved in this thing with Alex over at the tribe because I have a real concern for what's happening to our environment. I've heard of global warming for a long time, and I knew that it was affecting us. You know, we live in a small little world right here in Northwest Alaska, and we're seeing it. Of all the places in Alaska, Kotzebue, just Northwest Alaska, it was so transparent it wasn't even funny. You could see what's happening. Rather than the 4 month summers, now we've got 6 month summers, you know, maybe even longer. In the Arctic, we're having 70 degrees, 75 degrees in Kotzebue, and up in rivers, it gets, you know, 80, 90 degrees. As we produce more carbon dioxide into the air, it's going to get worse. As our tundra melts and more carbon gets into the air and more methane gas gets into the air, it's going to affect the greenhouse.
So it was myself and another grad student in our group named Suki, and the two of us retrieved a pair of radiometers that had been on top of the Fish and Wildlife bunkhouse for the entire length of the experiment. And those were measuring the incoming energy from the sun as well as energy being reflected by the clouds. So basic measurement for quantifying the greenhouse effect.
Yeah, that's perfect. All right, pause.
The radiometers on the Fish and Wildlife building were playing the role of gathering high standard measurements so we can trust their numbers to a high degree of accuracy. When comparing their numbers to the ones being measured out on the weather station, we saw that they line up, so that gave us a lot of confidence in our measurements.
The 5th, it's Friday the 5th of April. This is our last day going out on the ice on this trip. And to wrap things up, we're going to head out to the mass balance site on the river channel location. And we're going to pull out the met station that's been out there recording temperature and wind speed and so on.
So this is a met station, a meteorological station that we froze into the ice here back in January. And this has been measuring air temperature, wind speed, this dome here and this dome here. Measure how much energy from the sun and radiated energy from clouds has been landing on the ice surface. This here is actually a precipitation gauge. It can detect liquid precipitation pretty well, so it'd be interesting to see what this recorded a couple weeks ago when there was actually some pretty heavy rain here in March, which is pretty unusual. So this has been here collecting information that will tell us how much energy was landing on the ice surface or leaving the ice surface over the course of the last year. And that'll allow us to better understand how the ice has been thinning and thickening during that time. But the ice is getting thinner by the day right now, and we're not sure if this is still going to be safe when we come back in a few weeks' time. So we're going to pull the equipment now while we still can.
Bring those in where they're safe and we can get the data off them.
Tarim siko neglit muktok ukirarit man suli kayang naksisenyak mer nalap kanaksip yunilo.
I'm still observing and noticing the changes right now. For God's sake, we have open water out here. We still get a lot of snow. We don't get 50 below like we used to, you know. The dangers are there because the ice doesn't get thick anymore.
Ice cores were collected from different locations in the landfast ice near Kotzebue in 2018 and 2019. To get a better understanding of the thickness of ice over the span of winter and spring.
This is a core barrel that cuts a hole in the ice, but you can see it's just got two teeth here and here, so it cuts a ring of ice, and the plug of ice on the inside is kept intact. So we drill a hole, but then we get the inside of the hole, if you like. I'm about to take this here corer and pull out a core of the ice that we're standing on, like a vertical column, and then we can look at it to see what it's made of, what its history has been over the course of this last winter. Once we've got it out of the ice, we can take a look at it and whoa, see what it is exactly that we're standing on. This core, as we can see, it's broken up into lots of small pieces, and that happens when the ice is made up of more fresh water, which is what we'd expect for sea ice that's influenced by being so close to a river.
I'm gonna photograph it so that I can look at it later.
We can identify things like flooding events by doing this, and we can understand if it really is sea ice or if it is more river ice.
Andy, the lead of sea ice research, explains to the team how to read the story of the sea ice and how ice formation works.
This is at the freezing point. There's no heat flux, there's no temperature gradient through this section of ice, so you can't start growing at the bottom again until the slushy snow layer at the top is refrozen and you can conduct heat all the way through it. And that whiteness comes from the fact that there's a lot of air bubbles contained in here that scatters the light back at you. So it becomes more opaque and looks whiter to the eye. And that's really characteristic of flooded snow that has since refrozen. And that's a layer that we've seen in every core that we've taken so far.
The team found evidence in 2018 and 2019 of widespread flooding and freezing of the snow on top of the ice at some point during the winter. This means that the ice would have been thinner if the snow hadn't flooded, but it also means that there would have been less dry snow available for ring seal dens.
It is the middle of May now.
Open water just down from us here.
We're about 3.5 weeks into our trip and we're all going home tomorrow. We have had about 17 days straight in the field. And we've spent the rest of our time since then doing a lot of data crunching, staying up late on our computers on the couch to try and get some data ready just to show our Elder Advisory Council and give them a bit of a quick look at what we've been up to.
Long striations going down here.
We stopped going on the ice the 11th of May. We stopped going out because it just wasn't safe anymore to go out. Coming back from our last day on the ice, you could see how quickly the surface was melting. We certainly got as much out of our on ice work as we could have.
So this is it for our 2018 field season. For me and Kate, this is our last day here. It's the
ice is melting and the water is opening up behind us. This is the emergence of the river channel of the Kobuk and the Noatak rivers as the waters come past the waterfront in front of Kotzebue. And this was ice just a few days ago. A week ago, we took our last measurements of the thickness of this ice before it was deemed unsafe to go out onto anymore. And now it's completely open water with small chunks of ice drifting away. What a way to end out our time here in Kotzebue. Looking forward to coming back with the lessons learned from this year, learning to look at the ice in a new way.
I'm really grateful to have been part of this team and to become friends with a group of Indigenous leaders here in Kotzebue that I think will provide more opportunities for research. But in particular, there was one day that really stands out and I think exemplifies that. One day in the spring of 2019, we got to go out on the sea ice with Ross Schaefer when he was hunting Nutchik, a ring seal. And that's a very unique thing that, you know, most researchers certainly don't get to experience. And as a marine biologist who studies ring seals, it was so fascinating and exciting to be able to have a conversation with Ross and like talk about what he was doing.
It's a place with a lot of current, so it's open all the time. Some years it's frozen all the way, but not lately.
We could both be looking at the stomach of a ring seal and talking about, well, what did it eat? And, oh, well, that's from, you know, these little white things, those are the ear bones from tomcod. So just being able to share information in a very visual and hands-on way.
See, this is liver here. Looks good.
How would you know if it didn't look good? What would you be looking for?
Got spots, white spots on it.
And then to gain the perspective of what it's really like to be a hunter out on the ice and navigating these conditions that are maybe not as safe as they used to be, and thinking about what it really means to the people who care the most about some of these seals.
Ikaaġvik Sikukun Savaktot Nunakun Imikunlu Ukariksut Utokananun Kanok Aglangat Kangersiso Luni Kanok Ikayuto Luni Nyakiramun. Savakram Pakatit Gay Savaktit at Konaklu Sunik Kanok at Langol Hasikum.
A really important goal that will continue, maybe be a legacy of this project, will be to come back to the community, to contribute to the newsletters that we send to all the mailbox holders in the community, keep working with our filmmaker to contribute to the documentary and make sure that the message is getting out there, not just to the scientific community, but to the people who are affected here in Kotzebue and in the region, and for a broader audience as well.
We also hope that people can follow the path that we've tried to create to demonstrate how scientists can work with Indigenous communities, not just to answer questions, but even to be discovering what questions they should be asking to start with. The definition of hypotheses is fundamental to the scientific method. And to date, the Indigenous voice has been missing from that part of the scientific method.
Pretty much every time we try to acknowledge our tradition knowledge would they claim is invalid, basically because there's no documentation of what we know.
It took me a while to realize that this is what I'd been looking for. I've been working with Indigenous experts for a long time and often found it difficult to know how to really work their knowledge into my framework of understanding. And the answer seems obvious once you know it, but I think you've got to do it from the beginning. You can't plug it in halfway through or tack it onto the end. It sort of has to be in there from conception.
Like this project, I can see it's going to be real beneficial, basically, to the future, in the future, because we're validating what our people knew.
It's a really good hook. This is the design that all Eskimos had.
You see forums like that just about every year, from what I remember, after freeze is over.
Massive erosion is now eroding faster than most places. It is real. There's no doubt in my mind that the waters are rising.
Who can we get to champion this climate change problem that we have all over the world? And I'd like to challenge President Obama to take that initiative. When he came up here, there was hope we would see something happening. I challenge him to get that hope going, get that study going, get the people motivated to make changes so that the world will not end soon.
President Obama was up here, and he came up here because of climate change.
When it comes to climate change, there is such a thing as being too late. The effects can be irreversible if we don't act. And that moment is almost here. And you know this better than anybody. I want you to know, as your president, I'm here to make sure that you get the support that you need.
President Obama, you're welcome back to look at the changes again. Anybody that can make a difference in public policy, you know, make a difference with our congressmen saying, God, you got to recognize this as a threat to life on this planet.
Our methodology used in the Ikaaġvik Sikukun project included Indigenous knowledge from the very beginning. The research questions we developed reflect questions important to the community of Kotzebue and provide a holistic point of view. The Inupiaq meaning for Ikaaġvik Sikukun, ice bridges, was our symbol to keep our focus on bridging the understanding between Western science ways of knowing and Indigenous ways of knowing. We hope that our research findings allow us to share with the world a holistic view of how climate change is rapidly impacting the sea ice environment of Kotzebue Sound.
I want to see my great-great-grandchildren. I want them to wake up to an earth that's livable. I want them to be in your back, and I want them to go out and enjoy everything I see every day when I'm out in the country, the animals that we take to survive by. I want them to be there too. Because if we don't do anything, there's going to be nothing out there. The oceans will die. And we'll be extinct.